Hey guys, welcome back to Catholic NYC Presents. I'm Colin Nakaza. Before anything else, please join me in a prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I hope everybody had a good weekend. I hope you are healthy and safe. Welcome back to Catholic NYC Presents for a new week here. Very excited about tonight's talk. We've got Jean Zanotti, who is from Spiritual Strength, who's going to be giving our talk today. But before that, as you guys are hopefully used to now, I've been sharing different things about the messages of divine mercy when Jesus was appearing to a great saint in the Catholic Church, now Saint Faustina. And I've been talking a lot about the chaplet. And so I thought I'd just briefly go on how to pray the chaplet. So first off, it's very important that it's done on the rosary beads. Our Lady of Mercy is very involved when it comes to divine mercy. And you start off by doing an Our Father, a Hail Mary, an Apostles' Creed. And on the Our Father beads, you say, Eternal Father, I offer you the body, blood, soul, and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. And on the Hail Mary beads, you say, for the sake of his sorrowful passion, have mercy on us and on the whole world. And you go around, and at the very end, you say, Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us and on the whole world three times. And you can easily find it online. I also recommend you downloading the app that the Marian Fathers came out with from Stockbridge, Massachusetts. If you type in Divine Mercy in the App Store, you can see how to pray the chaplet, see the images and the different themes. And I'll just briefly read. This is what Jesus said about the chaplet for those who pray it. And this is his words to Saint Faustina speaking to all of us. He said, say unceasingly the chaplet that I have taught you. Whoever will recite it will receive great mercy at the hour of death. Priests will recommend it to sinners as their last hope of salvation. Even if there were a sinner most hardened, if he were to recite the chaplet only once, he would receive great grace from my infinite mercy. He says, even only once, I strongly recommend that you invite your family and friends, maybe when you're driving with them or something, to pray the chaplet, because he promises even once, especially those who may be far away from God. He says that the souls that will say this chaplet will be embraced by my mercy during their lifetime, and especially at the hour of death. And it's very, very powerful to pray the chaplet for those who are dying. And boy, do we need that now with all that's going on. So I strongly encourage you once a day to please pray the Divine Mercy chaplet for those who are dying. And this is what God the Father actually has to say about that. And this is from God the Father to St. Faustina. He says, at the hour of their death, I defend as my own glory every soul that will say this chaplet. Or when others say it for a dying person, the pardon is the same. When they say this chaplet by the bedside of a dying person, God's anger is placated, unfathomable mercy envelops the soul, and the very depths of my tender mercy are moved for the sake of the sorrowful passion of my Son. So powerful. And then Jesus says this, oh, what great graces I will grant to souls who say this chaplet. The very depths of my tender mercy are stirred for the sake of this of those who say this chaplet. So again, invite you to please pray that, play the chaplet every single day. And I'm very excited to welcome Jean Zanotti, who is from the Spiritual Strength. And then Jean, please take it from here.
All right. Thanks a lot, Colin. Thanks for having me. Appreciate it. Obviously a huge, huge fan of Divine Mercy. I run a monthly group actually in downtown Manhattan at St. Joseph's in Greenwich Village, where we discuss Spiritual Strength Presents Divine Mercy and Mary. We talk about the Blessed Mother. We talk about the united, how the Sacred Heart of Jesus, Immaculate Heart of Mary, and the Most Chaste Heart of St. Joseph are united. But to give you a little background on myself, I played sports my whole life. Me, both my younger brothers, we were nationally ranked, all Ivy League wrestlers. And I wound up starting a business related to sports psychology. So my two master's degrees, I've one in exercise science, sports psychology, and one in clinical psychology. And from there, I built a whole business around helping athletes become more mentally tough, more confident, relaxing under pressure. So basically, we work with some of the toughest teams in the country, some of the top NCAA champs, state champs, right through the US Olympic teams and professional athletes. So basically taking some of these tough athletes and making them even tougher. But the idea is, we always say, if you could have all the physical strength in the world, you could have all the mental strength, But if you don't have spiritual strength, you're weak. And a lot of people talk about being the total package, spirit, mind, and body, but they don't actually put that into effect. Especially right now in the time we're in, during this coronavirus, we have to keep focusing on improvement. And we talk about improving spiritually, improving mentally, and improving physically. So there's always something we could be doing every day to get better. And we say with spiritual strength, as an athlete for Christ, everyone's an athlete for Christ. So maybe you never played a sport before in your life, but if you look at St. Paul, he uses a lot of sports analogies. He uses a lot of spiritual warfare analogies. He says, run the race as to win the prize. He says, we're not shadow boxing, right? It's a real fight. We're the church militant. He says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So we're all spiritual athletes. We're all spiritual warriors. And we need to remember that. And in order to know that, first thing, we need to know who we're fighting against. What does the enemy look like? I can't defeat an opponent if I don't know who the opponent is. So again, look right there. It's right there in the Bible. The world, the flesh, and the devil. That's the enemy. That's our opponent. So we're building that spiritual strength. The first thing, our biggest enemy is always ourself. We look at the seven deadly sins. The mnemonic device to remember that is pale gas, P-A-L-E, gas, G-A-S. Pride, anger, lust, envy, greed, avarice, and sloth. Gluttony, avarice, and sloth. So we got to know that's winning the battle within. You got to win that battle within. And then, of course, there is a real spiritual battle that's going on, that we are fighting against the devil and demons, and they're trying to destroy us. So we have to know how to fight against them too. And of course, the world, ideologies that are anti-Catholic, the whole modernism and liberalism that a lot has crept into all parts of life, even in sometimes parts of the church. So we have to be able to stand strong. And as athletes for Christ, we need to know the way, show the way, and go the way. That means we got to know what it is. We got to know how to, and we got to be doing it ourselves. We got to be living it. It's no good if we're not walking that walk. So I also like in the epistles where we hear our spirit, soul, and body. Right? We're spirit, soul, and body. So we always talk about mind, body, and spirit. We got to be the total package. During this time, it's so important to remember that, and as we approach Holy Week especially, yes, we have to suffer. We have, we got to go to Good Friday in order to get to Easter Sunday. But that being said, we are resurrection people. We're people of hope. So positivity now, resiliency, and being able to see opportunity during adversity. The Easter Sunday always comes after the cross. So we have to stand strong. So in our minds, we got to make sure we're ready. So we're doing things. You could actually take this time. I know we're in a very tough situation right now, not having access to the sacraments being available to us. But what we have to do is we have to see what's the opportunity. Is there any opportunity that this could bring up for me? Well, I know we could increase our prayer life. Make sure we're praying the daily rosary. You could start up a schedule of prayer. So beautiful tradition. I strongly encourage to the Blessed Mother getting in the habit of saying the Angelus at 6 a.m. I'm not up at that time, so, but 12 noon and 6 p.m. If you could do it at 6 a.m., 12 noon and 6 p.m., God bless you. You're a champ. Do it. If you're not up at the 6 o'clock hour, so you could say it when you wake up in the morning. Getting in the habit, make a schedule. I tell our athletes when we're working with our high-level athletes, we're saying they have to have a schedule for their exercise. And that's something also for your body. You want to have an exercise, a little conditioning you could do, a little bit of strength training, even if it's just push-ups, air squats, jump rope, being creative. I was shooting a video actually on our Instagram yesterday, balcony workouts. I was linking up my rubber bands where I was doing some exercises on the balcony, staying safe, but at the same time also getting that workout in. But like I was saying before, having that prayer schedule for yourself, the chaplet at 3 p.m. Why not? You could set your clock so it goes off at 12 noon for the Angelus, 3 p.m. for the chaplet, 6 p.m. for the Angelus. There's also a beautiful devotion, the three hearts, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph. There is an alleged apparition, Ida Paranga, Brazil, in the 90s into the 2000s, where there was a consecration prayer to St. Joseph. A lot of you probably did the consecration to St. Joseph, Father Calloway's. I just did that last month. Super exciting. Well, one of the prayers that they recommended in that apparition, again, it was neither approved nor unapproved, but in the morning, in the afternoon, and in the evening, you say Sacred Heart of Jesus, Immaculate Heart of Mary, Most Chaste Heart of Saint Joseph, I consecrate to you this, and you'd say morning, afternoon, or evening, my mind, and you make the sign of the cross over your forehead, my words over your lips, my body, my heart, and my soul, so that your will might be done through me this morning, afternoon, or evening. Anyway, it's just a very powerful thing. And either way, we do want to be consecrated to the three hearts of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph. You know, there's another group that I run. We started the first ever Central Jersey Militia Immaculata. And if you know about, if you've done the 33 Days to Morning Glory, you know about St. Maximilian Kolbe. And that was the second section that they did in the book, and how St. Maximilian Kolbe started the Militia Immaculata to fight against Freemasonry. Basically, we say the world, the flesh, and the devil, right? So Maximilian Kolbe started the Militia Immaculata as a recognition that we're part of the church militant. You know, we used to get confirmed, our grandparents, when they were confirmed, they got a little smack on the cheek by the bishop, which basically meant, hey, you're a soldier for Christ, now get out there. So St. Maximilian Kolbe made us aware that, okay, yes, we're fighting against the world, the flesh, and the devil. And the other part of St. Maximilian Kolbe's Militia Immaculata was intense devotion to the Blessed Mother. And we know that whenever you have the heart of Jesus, you always have the hearts of Mary and Joseph. Jesus and Mary and Joseph, they're so united. They're always a team. So, and it's interesting because New Jersey does not have a Militia Immaculata that was ever set up before. We're the first one. New York City does not have, I think the only one in New York is actually upstate by Buffalo. So one of the things I'd like to get going is a Militia Immaculata in New York City. In fact, one of the things that we're doing interesting now is we're running weekly webinars with our Divine Mercy and Mary, alternating that and the Militia Immaculata live. I could send that information over to you, Colin, after the show, just in case anyone wanted to join. And it's important to have things you're doing to fortify yourself on a regular basis. These Catholic NYC programs are excellent, unbelievable. And when these speakers are on, I hope you guys are there taking notes, guys and girls. You're taking notes, writing down tips. Every little thing that you could learn is great. I've been saying a lot that during this time, my biggest fear is that things go back to normal and we say to ourselves, man, I could have done more during this time. I had all this extra time and I didn't do more. I didn't grow in virtue. That's what we do with our business, using sports as a vehicle to build virtue and these mental skills, the confidence, mental toughness, relaxing under pressure. And then with spiritual strength, our ministry, we're using sports as a vehicle to understand the faith, right? To be an athlete for Christ. So they work together. They're not mutually exclusive. We're spirit, soul, and body. So we have to take this time and improving in all those different ways. So improving not only in our prayers, our vocal prayers, but also taking time for mental prayer. Okay, so one of the things I do in spiritual direction, I go to Opus Dei in New Jersey, over at Southmont. I've been over to Murray Hill over there. They're the national headquarters. And my spiritual director, Father Bob, speaks a lot about the importance of mental prayer. That means just taking time to quietly be alone with the Lord. And it's tough. It's not easy. His advice to me was 10 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes in the evening, just quietly sit alone with the Lord. It's hard because you feel like you want to do more. You feel like nothing's happening. We have to remember, though, when even you look at the image of Divine Mercy, Jesus is taking the step towards us. Prayer is a response to God who's already made the first move. Look at Jesus's foot in the Divine Mercy image. It's step towards us. God makes the first move towards us. And we want, and I know as an athlete, we try to force and make it happen instead of letting it happen. In fact, the reading I'm doing right now, just to show you, The Ways of Mental Prayer. This is a spiritual classic by Lahoti. Strong recommendation by Father Ripperger. Those of you that know me know that I'm a huge Father Ripperger fan. I just devour everything I could watch of him on YouTube. And he's just great. Just really makes a lot of sense with how he explains the faith. But nonetheless, this Ways of Mental Prayer book, it's been really good so far. Actually, this week, I've taken a little detour and I've been going into the Dolorous Passion and I've been going into the Mystical City of God. Since now we're entering into the we're in Holy Week right now. I like to see what the mystics, the ones that had visions of what actually took place during Holy Week, Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, Venerable Mary Agreda. I like to see, what did they see? What was going on? Of course, first and foremost, you have scripture, right? You read the Bible, you see the passion account there. And then these accounts, these mystical experiences, they help fill in the gaps of what else was going on there. And it's just really beautiful to see that. So I took a little hiatus there from my mental prayer book to going into Dolores Passion, as well as the Mystical City of God, great books. But mental prayer, it's hard. It's not easy, because we always want to force, we want to do more. We think the more prayers we say, the more power it has. And a part of that is true, right? The rosary, we know it's powerful. How many times does the Blessed Mother have to appear until we start and say to us, pray the rosary every day until we actually do it? I know really her great desire would be that we pray all the mysteries every day, but crawl before you walk, walk before you run, run before you fly, right? So you have those set prayers that you're saying, but also just taking that time quietly with the Lord and let him work on you, because our main defects, we know we're fallen people, we're broken. We can't fix it on our own. You can't say enough prayers to make it go away. You need grace. I need grace. So we got to take that time to sit quietly with the Lord. But setting a plan of action, what's your prayer schedule like? Are you making spiritual communions throughout the day? That's a powerful thing. We don't have access to the sacraments, but we could always make a spiritual communion, asking the Lord to come into our heart. Now, I know that's not the same exact thing, but many spiritual writers have said that, and saints have said that it could be just as efficacious as a real communion. By no means are we putting down receiving the sacraments. You receive the sacraments as frequently as you possibly can. But as a Catholic, you should never let a day go by in your life without receiving communion. If you can't do it physically, you do it spiritually, even when we have access to those sacraments again. So setting a prayer schedule, and then God willing, we come out of this whole coronavirus, then you have to, again, adapt your action plan. Just like I tell our athletes, once your schedule changes, you need to update your action plan. I was a personal trainer for a while, sports nutritionist. I asked many people while I worked at a gym, when did you get off track? Have you ever been on track? And almost everyone says, yes, I followed this diet for 3 months, or I followed this exercise plan for 5 months. And I say, okay, what changed? And they said, well, I got a new job, or they finished school, or some kind of change in their schedule happened, and boom, now they were off track. So anytime, what I'm a strong recommendation, anytime your schedule changes, you have to update your action plan. And remember, your action plan should consist of spirit, mind, and body. It's got to be all of them. But again, we have to be aware. We know that enemy is out there. The enemy is going to do everything in his power to block you, right? So we need to make sure we're launching an attack against him. So a couple just great tips. We talk about this in our book, Spiritual Strength. I'll put a link in the show below. But we just got this published. We got a great shout out on the back from Cardinal Burke. We got the imprimatur. So I'm super excited about that. I was very pumped to write the book, talking all about, like we said, building athletes for Christ. Some of the sacramentals we talk about in there, the importance of the St. Benedict medal. The St. Benedict medal is the only medal that exists that has an exorcism blessing that's put on it. So you want to wear that. And one of the promises in that St. Benedict medal is to physically protect you from disease and sickness. That's pretty important right now. Okay, so the St. Benedict medal, and there's a special blessing that goes along with that. Also, I saw a YouTube video of an exorcist talking about the importance of exorcised water. So now priests can bless water. You have holy water, but there's a step further. Okay, so in the old rite, before Vatican II, they had a separate blessing, and they had exorcisms that can be put on water. So here's the household items. This is the mnemonic device. You could see, I think in terms of mnemonic devices, the school psychologist in me, cows, like the animal, cows, C-O-W-S, candles, olive oil, water, and salt. All four of those can have exorcism blessings put on them. So I know I probably look like a lunatic sometimes. I bring over water, olive oil, salt, or candles to the priest. I have the old rite blessings on my phone. I could send that over to all of you after, but that's I have that right there. I'm able to bring it over to the priest. He can exorcise the candles. And we know that, so again, back to Father Ripperger, who started the Order of Dolorans, who were exorcist priests, a whole order dedicated to exorcism. He said that the more specific the prayers, the greater power it has. Prayer begets what it signifies. Lex orandi, lex credendi. As we pray, so we believe. So the prayers that are put on the exorcism water are very specific to, that the priest puts on. We can't bless water ourselves. Are very specific in fighting the demons. And candles, exorcised candles, are very strong with fighting demons of the air. So there's different classes of demons. They fight the demons of the air. And anytime if we ever use bad language or gossip, whatever, we lie, that opens it up for demons in the air. So you want those candles to help wash that out. And then, of course, we work on those personal defects ourselves. So that stuff, we put that all in the book. It's very easy to understand. It's all right there. Simple format. But we have to make sure that we're using, capitalizing on those exorcism blessings. We're not even aware of that. In terms of knowing the way, how much are we studying about the faith? So there's several readings we need to be doing. Number one, you have your Bible reading first and foremost. Every day, simplest thing you could do is read whatever gospel of is the gospel of the day. So if we're on John chapter 7, I'll just read the whole read that whole chapter that day. Actually, I'm kind of getting ahead of myself there. I don't actually read the Bible. My Bible reads to me on my phone. I have the Truth and Life app. Like that little soundbite. I don't read the Bible. My Bible reads to me. It's called Truth and Life, and has great commentary on there from a lot of the church fathers, the catechism. So I love it. So Truth and Life app on my phone. You could play it and you listen to the Bible. But read the gospel every day. Next, you want to have some kind of spiritual reading that's going to fortify you, whether it's a writing of the saints, whatever. Very important. I like to start with the classics. See, when I think in terms of sports or athletics, if I want to get you in shape, if I'm training you, I'm going to start with the core. I'm going to start with making sure you have good stability, mobility. I want to build up a rock solid foundation, and then we could start building up other parts of the body, right? Makes sense. So the same thing when we're talking about spiritual reading, I like to start with the classics. Start with things that have been around for a very long time that are time tested, tried and true, and then you build off of that foundation. Nothing wrong with modern writers. Heck, that's what I'm doing. I'm a modern writer, right? But it's so important to start with the classics. Build that solid foundation. That's why I like a lot of books pre-1955. They're just really great. And you just see that over time, they've been tested. So they're very good. So we got to have our spiritual reading. And then also you want to have some theology where you're actually learning about the faith. And it's very important to read a lot of the papal encyclicals, even those that go back a long time. So one of the cool books that I recently looked at, and I haven't read all of them in here. Let me see if I can find it. Yeah, it's right over here. So here's this, The Popes Against Modern Errors. So these are 16 papal encyclicals. And as, you know, sport athlete kind of personality, hard-hitting condemnations of many of today's most noxious errors. Two really good ones that I just read was Pope St. Pius X, Pascendi on modernism, and talking about how the that whole modernism, which is the heresy of all heresies, is basically crept into all different areas of society, even into ourselves. We've all been infected by modernism to some extent. And he really does a very good job at explaining what it is and how we could overcome that. Another great one, simple one, Blessed Pius IX. Blessed Pope Pius IX, he's the one in Ineffabilis Deus who declared the third Marian dogma, the Immaculate Conception. He wrote a great book, The Syllabus of Errors. It's basically just a list of 80 errors in thinking. Really good, because I think it helps unclutter our thinking when we get rock solid and understanding the faith. And like I said, the spiritual reading is different than the theology reading, and you need both. You got to have both, because it's not just head knowledge. The goal, the end result of the reading is not to be just to be smart, right? Knowledge puffs up, but it's to get us living a greater life of holiness, bringing us closer to the Lord, loving our neighbor as ourselves. So real important. You want to have that reading there. Enter into Holy Week. Really be present. There used to be a whole list. I saw this on Sensus Fidelium, Father Ripperger's channel. Talks about there used to be a whole set of criteria what you needed to be a saint, like actually the checklist as they were looking to canonize someone to be a saint. And one of the things they spoke about was, I forget the exact terminology, but how much does this person enter into the passion? How much do they have a love for Christ crucified, for the sorrowful mother? There's something in us as Catholics that has to always hold that, and not in a stoic way, but in a way that we understand that we embrace the cross. Christianity is not just a whole feel-good thing and just using God to make me successful. And I got to be honest, back in my competing days in sports, I would pray before I would wrestle out there, before, you know, against some top competition. And what was I really doing. I didn't mean to, but it was trying to use God for my success. Now, is it wrong to pray before you compete, before you take a big test, before a job interview? No, of course not. St. Paul tells us we should pray at all times. So of course you pray, but it's not a matter of a whole prosperity gospel and just using the Lord to help me be successful. The goal is not successful. The goal is fruitful. The goal is fruitful. And if we're docile to the movements of the Holy Spirit, if we give all of ourselves to God, if we make that consecration, He bears the fruit. We don't bear the fruit. He does it 30, 60, and 100 fold. We mess up when we try to do too much. So we got to give ourselves entirely to the Lord. That's a huge part of what spiritual strength is about. So we got to take the bull by the horns, have that action plan for our prayer life. Have that action plan for your exercise. What are things you could do while you're in this period of time? We released a whole series of exercise videos. We put them out all for free on our Instagram page. We have a 10-minute abs workout, 10-minute arms, 10-minute legs, where it's all high-intensity body weight training. That was actually my first business before I started Winning Mindset. And so you have something like that. Are there push-ups you could do? Air squats, burpees, looking at fitness channels, staying in shape. Also, are we working on our mindset? That's a big deal too. Remember, the Lord gave you a brain. You have the free will. You have intellect. Are we working on how we deal with situations, how we treat other people, how we're processing information? A lot of times where I could tell you a big cause of a lot of some of the lowest areas we see, substance abuse, depression, anxiety, suicide. I don't take any of that stuff lightly. And a lot of that is because we're focused too much comparing ourselves to other people, looking around at what's going on around us, focusing too much on outcomes. You know, we think too much like, why am I not in a relationship? Why don't I have this kind of car? Why don't I have this, that, or the other thing? We're focused too much on what's going on around us instead of focusing on things within our control. How do I be more positive? How do I be more grateful? Being thankful for all the opportunities that are given to us. That's an important thing. You know, my doctoral program, I was real surprised at that. The opposite of depression and sadness is not happiness. Really? You think the opposite of being sad is being happy? No, the opposite of being depressed and sad is being thankful, having an attitude of gratitude. And I could tell you, at the University of Pennsylvania, where I went to school, they started positive psychology. And one of the big things they do to help people out of that sadness, and I can't even imagine now, I mean, that's a key right now, isolation, that definitely contributes to a sadness being down in the dumps. So make sure you reach out to people, make sure you still talk to friends, make sure you get them part of different prayer groups, you know, just get involved somehow virtually in things, because when we're isolated, that's what the devil wants. The devil's all about division. The Lord is about uniting everyone, bringing everyone together. The Lord is about communion. The devil is about division, right? Divide and conquer, that whole thing. So we got to make sure we're thankful. So every day, psychologists will recommend you have a gratitude journal, or you write a letter to someone who's helped you in the past, and you read that letter to that person, thanking them for all their help. So it's all about thanks and having an attitude of gratitude. And I laugh because when I hear this is what the recent psychology studies are, I'm glad science has caught up with this knowledge we've known for some 3,000 years. You look at a lot of the Psalms, they're praise and thanksgiving. And if you look at Psalms 22, especially during Holy Week, I'd like you to look at Psalms 22, where Jesus said, my God, why have you abandoned me? Why have you forsaken me? It's widely believed by theologians now that when Christ said that, he actually said the entire Psalm. When you read it, unbelievably powerful description of what Christ looked like and what he was going through. I have a passion crucifix here, right here, from the precious blood, where you could really see what was going on. But in that prayer, even during the agony, you hear the praise and the thanksgiving. There's a joy even in the suffering. And we can experience, if we unite all of our sufferings to Christ, there can be a joy. There's still going to be pain, but it transforms our suffering. Our faith is much more than a set of rules and a set of laws that we follow. It's a participation in Christ. And as the head, so the body. Christ is the head, we're the body. What connects the head and the body, by the way? The neck. That's why Mary's called the nexus. Mary connects the head and the body. We have to follow in Christ's footsteps. We suffer, but we unite our suffering to him. And in that, then we resurrect with him. He raises us up on the last day. So Psalm 22, Isaiah 52 and 53, the suffering servant. But back to that whole attitude of gratitude, we have to remember all the things that we're thankful for. And it's not easy, right? A lot of people think when I go in, I work with teams on mindset. They think mindset's all about positivity, is hold hands in a circle and rainbows and sunshine and butterflies. No, being positive is a very difficult thing. When you're having a bad day, when times are tough, you say three things that you're thankful for. You say five things you're thankful for, and that'll help snap you out of it. Is it going to change everything? No, but you're starting to see the upside. There's a lot of opportunities that this whole period of time is opening us up to connect with old friends, to get closer to the Lord, to be more giving, to find some kind of way to give, to maybe start that book you always intended on writing, to get in better shape. And again, this week being Holy Week, definitely first and foremost, getting close to the Lord, getting in the habit of making spiritual communions. So when God willing, these sacraments are brought back to us, you're still making spiritual communions throughout the day. You know, some of my favorite people to learn from are the Friars of the Immaculate. The Friars of the Immaculate, I visited them up in Griswold, Connecticut, 2 years ago. They're also the friars that run the Cardinal Burke's place up in Wisconsin, at the National Shrine of Our Lady of Guadalupe. Hardcore Marian devotion. So they take three vows, poverty, obedience, chastity. They take a fourth vow, the Marian vow, their consecration to the Blessed Mother. And that's why you always see them wearing the miraculous medal. Strong recommendation, always wear that miraculous medal. Always wear the brown scapular. Always wear the St. Benedict medal. It's so important. It's all there. We have beautiful traditions in the church. Something I'll post up a link to my blog after. During times of the plague and pestilence, this is nothing new. The church has seen this over 2,000-year period. There's a plague cross you could put on your door. There's a badge of the precious blood. Father Chris Alar of the Marians of the Immaculate Conception said, put a picture of divine mercy out on your door. There's beautiful things you could do. There's holy water. Again, the church has ways that they've spiritually fortified us over time. So we want to capitalize on all that. Again, I'm happy anyone has any questions. I know we hit on a lot of information, but I say it over and over again, be in the total package, right? Spirit, mind, and body. We take sports. We just use that as a metaphor to understand the faith, right? The athlete for Christ knows the way, shows the way, and goes the way. Being the total package, spirit, mind, and body, right? So we want to make sure we take the bull by the horns. We improve. We see opportunity during this time. We embrace Holy Week. We draw closer to the Lord, and we just let him more into our life. Being docile to the movements of the Holy Spirit, that's the name of the game. So I wish you and your family a blessed Holy Week and a wonderful Easter coming up. Take care. God bless you and God bless your families. Thanks for having me.
Gene, thanks so much. I've known you for a while now, and I've always loved your sound bites, and I love the attitude of gratitude. I forget it was Dr. Greg Bertoro or if it was Jackie Mulligan, but she said even in the chemistry of the mind, like, you can't be depressed and thankful at the same time. So it's such a powerful thing. Gene, how can people get your book? How can they get onto your blog? Can you send how to get in contact with you?
Yes. So I will send you the link. The best bet is our Linktree. So our Linktree has our website, our podcast, our YouTube page, our book. All that information is right there. So can I send it to you on this chat?
Yeah, and also, yeah, and you can just tell us that now, and we can also send it afterwards as well. But yeah, I think you just send it on the, well, you had to send it on the Facebook chat, but that's okay. We can do it after. And so guys, please type in any questions you may have for Gene. And Gene, I've been asking all of our speakers this because we've really been hitting home that it's so important to stay in routine. You know, it's because we're all homebound, it's so easy to get lazy. Can you just share with us how you've been balancing your work life, your family, and your prayer life?
Got to put the Lord first. That's first and foremost. And again, we all make mistakes. I'm certainly not perfect with all this, but to the best of my ability, it's put the Lord first. My family, you know, it's a beautiful time. I have my wife, I have my son, she's pregnant. We got another baby due, another boy due in August. So it's great to spend this time together. I work on my computer. I got my little office right here. I'll be able to take breaks in between, getting workouts in between. My wife and I will sometimes exercise together. We'll take breaks. We'll usually pray the chaplet at noon together. And then we're also with the business. So we have a virtual business where we work with athletes and teams all around the country on Zoom, like here, or Skype, or on the phone. So it's really just seeing opportunity, using social media, connecting with people. But back to your question, it's putting the word first. If you, it's important to make the most important. The most important thing is to make the most important thing the most important thing. There's your soundbite right there. If you do that, everything else falls into place. Live a Christ-centered life. Things will take care of themselves.
So as you know, most of us are homebound. Do you have any suggestions on two things? One, any workouts. You said you had your Instagram workouts they can do, but also how can we help develop that attitude for positivity? Do you have any mental exercises you can suggest? Yeah.
Anytime you catch yourself criticizing, blaming, or complaining right off the bat, first and foremost, offer it up. We don't do that. We waste so much of our suffering now. Don't waste your suffering. Suffering is precious. And I know it's easy to say when you're feeling well, it's a lot tougher when you're having a difficult time. So, you know, very important, but offer up your suffering and say three things that you're thankful for, because you're right. You cannot be down in the dumps and thankful at the same time. They clash. They don't go together. Pull out the Psalms, pray the Psalms, give praise and thanksgiving. And remember that when we're suffering in difficult times, that's when we're the closest to Christ. When all the saints have said this, that when we feel like our prayer is the most dry, oh, that was horrible, I couldn't pay attention, I tried, that might have been the closest you ever were to the Lord in your life. So don't lose the hope. Keep looking through the world with supernatural lenses.
And what was the Truth in Life app you mentioned? That's not, the Bible.
It's a great Bible app. Just Truth in Life. Any of the stuff I could send on over to you, could pump it out to everyone. But I think it's $30 for the Bible commentary. Well worth it, though. Well worth it. Excellent Bible commentary.
And how's your family doing? I know, you know, this has been a tough time for a lot of people. How you been doing?
Yeah, good. Thanks be to God. We have two people in the extended family that have it. So we're praying for them. My house, my immediate family, my wife's family, everyone's safe. So it's just, you know, you be thankful for everything you have. That's all you could do. All you could ask for is opportunity. Right. So.
Well, Gene, I cannot thank you enough for being on the show. Guys, please tune in tomorrow night. We've got Genie and Jim Gaffigan. If you know Jim Gaffigan, he's a famous comedian. He's absolutely hilarious. But they'll be coming on and talking about some of the serious stuff that's been happening in the city and how they've been helping. And Genie Gaffigan, his wife's got quite a story. So we hope you guys tune in. And then the next night after that, we have Jackie and Bobby Angel, who are great chastity speakers, are going to be talking about how to stay chaste while you're homebound and just give us suggestions some type of temptations that many of us could be going through during this time. But before we leave, just please join me again in a prayer in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And you can see all of these talks downloaded on the Catholic NYC Presents YouTube channel. So please subscribe to that. This is our 10th episode, believe it or not, and all 10 episodes will be our download on there. But guys, we are very much praying for you. Know that we love you. We will keep you updated with all that's been going on in New York, especially when it comes to young adult outreach. And please tune in tomorrow night. But stay safe and stay healthy. God bless.